I see your screen and I hear you well, so it must be all right. Our next speaker is a colleague of mine now, Dmitry Matsukevich from CQT and the National University of Singapore. He's going to talk about hybrid quantum computations with spin and motional states of trapped ions. And with this, the floor is yours, Dmitry.
Thank you very much. And first of all, thank you to the organizers for inviting me to this workshop. So my talk will be a little bit different from the previous talks. First of all, I'm not going to talk about error corrections with bosonic codes. I will focus on the other applications that Liang mentioned in the first talk. In particular, I'm going to focus on how can we use this bosonic modes for quantum computation, in particular how we can use them for some kind of machine learning. Okay, I'm the experimentalist. I work with trapped ions. And for those of you who are not familiar with trapped ions, well, the ions are just atoms that have internal levels. And they are trapped in, typically in our case, in the pole traps. So they have the motional degrees of freedom. And that's 2 degrees of the spin and motion is 2 degrees of freedom that we can control very well in the trapped ion system. So if we look, typically when people talk about quantum computation with trapped ions, they talk about qubits and about spins. When you look at the Hilbert space of this system, you find that for n ions, you have 2^n dimension of your Hilbert space. It's not bad. I mean, you can trap a lot of ions and build like a 20, 30, 50 qubit quantum computer. But in addition to this Hilbert space, you also have another degree of freedom. You have the motion of the ions in trap, which is basically mechanical oscillators. If you have, let's say, n ions in the trap, you actually have 3 n independent modes of motion, and each of them can be modeled as a harmonic oscillator. So the Hilbert space in this case is much larger, infinity to the power of 3 n, because harmonic oscillator has infinite number of energy levels. So if we can use this large Hilbert space of bosonic modes for quantum computations, well, maybe we can get some advantages, at least, you know, compared to this qubit approach, purely qubit approach, at least for some specialized stuff. Okay, so we all know how to build what is the universal set of gate in case of the qubit. So if you want to implement any unitary transformation on a set of qubit, all you need to do is a single qubit rotations plus one entangling 2-qubit gate, for example, a synod. Okay, when you talk about computations about using continuous variable, when you talk about using the states of harmonic oscillator for your computation, well, there is also a set of gate which is universal. Well, first of all, you have to implement all this Gaussian operator like displacement, rotation, squeezing, and beam splitter transformation. And this operation just takes, you know, coherent or squeeze states and bring and produce at the end also like coherent or squeeze state. And in addition, to make it universal, you need some kind of nonlinear gate, right? And in system of trapped ions, well, we can use, we can implement this nonlinearity in the several different ways. So the first way, well, is to use a Coulomb interaction between the ions, right? So even if, you know, our trap is big and harmonic, when you put 2 ions close together, well, they interact to each other through the Coulomb interaction. And this Coulomb interaction is not harmonic, at all, right? So it goes as 1/r, and it's actually introduced noticeable unharmonicity to our trapped ion system. And our group actually did some of it. So we implemented, for example, this degenerate parametric amplifier, non-degenerate parametric amplifier, and crosshair effect with trapped ions. So in principle, we can have this cubic and even higher order nonlinearity in trapped ions directly. Another way to implement, to introduce some nonlinearity is, well, to couple it, to couple this harmonic modes to spin. Well, usually, you know, the interaction between the oscillator and the spin is unharmonic, is nonlinear. So, and in this model, our information is stored in, let's say, bosonic modes, right? And the spin is spin of the qubit of the ions actually used as the mediator for this to make this mode interact with the control plane. Okay, so what kind of gate we want to have? I mean, in principle, a lot of gates will work, so we naturally have basically J. Scammons interaction between spin and motion and trapped ions, which is easy to implement. But the gates that we actually want and the gates that have a lot of application in this system is a control swap gate. So what this gate does? It flips the state of, let's say, mode A and mode B if the ion is in, if the qubit, control qubit is in the excited state, and it does nothing if the control qubit is in the ground state. Okay, if you can do that, well, you can do a lot of things. You can, for example, test how well this state two states overlap. So you can you can basically, using this simple circuit, you can estimate the overlap between two pure quantum states. Or if you have, for example, two mixed states, two copies of the same mixed state, you can also use the same circuit to find out what is the purity of this measurement. Okay, so our goal is to implement control swap gate. And the question is, well, how can we do it? Okay, so we work with trapped ions, and our tools is the coupling of spin and motion and all kind of motional sidebands. Just in case for the, you know, if some people come from the superconducting community and not exactly familiar with what we are doing with trapped ions, well, we rely on this motional sidebands to couple spin and motion. So imagine we have two laser field with a frequency difference, which is exactly the frequency difference between two energy level of our trapped ions where we encode the qubit. Well, if we apply two laser fields like this and we start with the ground state, well, we drive the transition between ground and excited state and we flip a spin, right? And that corresponds to this carrier transition in our case. So, but if we detune one of the laser by, let's say, one trap frequency from this carrier transition, well, we start seeing the smaller peaks, which corresponds to the, which are called motional sidebands, which corresponds to the case when we flip a spin and we add or remove one excitation to one of the motional modes. Okay, so that's the first order sidebands, and all we need is just tune the frequency of one of the lasers. But there is, and well, it's probably sufficient to control your oscillator, but since we want to build the control swap gate, so we want to look more closely at this tiny sidebands, which are second order and lab decay parameters, so everything slows down by a factor like 5 to 10. And this oscillators, this sidebands corresponds to the transitions where we flip the spin of the ion. And at the same time, we take excitation from one mode, one motional mode, and put it to the other mode. So the Hamiltonian that describes this interactions looks like this for one sideband and similar except And similar Hamiltonian for the other side band, right? One corresponds to flipping spin up, another corresponds to flipping spin down. Otherwise, they are the same. Okay, if we now drive both of them at the same time, so we just need to add this Hamiltonians, so we end up with the frequency, with the Hamiltonian, that looks very much like a beam splitter, right? A dagger B times sigma X. But now the beam splitter actually depends on the internal state of the ion. So we have some kind of control beam splitter, probably in some interaction picture where the, you know, the spin independent beam splitter interaction is always on. One state causes beams, this in evolution, another, well, doesn't. Okay, is it enough to implement the control slope gate? Well, turns out it's almost enough, except for the small and annoying phase factor. Well, imagine, well, you would think if you come from optics, you know, you have two beams, you put a mirror so that one mode reflects to another and another reflects back to the first one. It should swap the states, right? And now that's not quite correct. So if you look at this beam splitter transformation and you let it evolve until, you know, the modes are swapped, well, your state actually gains this phase factor, which depends on the number of excitation in both modes, A and B. So if you continue applying this transformation and return to the initial state, right, and return all the energy, basically populations back to the initial modes, well, you gain this minus one factor to the power of NA plus NB. Well, it's easy to understand for me, you know, using this analogy between beam splitter transformation and angular momentum transformation in this Schwinger representation for angular momentum, right? So in this case, well, your beam splitter is just Jx, x component of the angular momentum. And now if you have a boson, you know, if your angular momentum is integer, 2π rotation of the spin returns it to initial state. If your spin is half integer, 2π rotation of this object gives you the minus sign. Okay, so that's why where the spin comes from. So it's almost this control beam splitter, it's almost a swap gate except for phase factor. But what we can see if this, let's say one of these modes in the vacuum state, well, this operation is basically a parity operator, right? You do the 2π operation rotation, you end up with minus one in front of odd states, odd Fock states, and you end up with plus one in front of even odd states. So in superconducting qubits, it's easy operation, and trapped ions, we need to work a little bit more. So now, if we combine this parity operation with the control beam splitter that we have, it turns out we can actually take care of this phase factor and implement the control swap operation. So we need three modes of motion for that, and we need this parity operator and this 100 to one beam splitter. And then in some rotating frame, this set of gate is equivalent to the swap gate. So when we measure spin, for example, after producing these gates, it gives us the overlap between two states. And what is nice, it's a constant depth circuit. It doesn't really depend on dimensionality of our state. So I can have two-dimensional Hilbert space, 100-dimensional, infinitely dimensional Hilbert space, the complexity is still the same. Okay, as I told you, we are experimentalists, so we want to implement it with our trapped ions. And in order to do it, we trap two ions and we address two radial modes of motion with our lasers. So we choose three of these modes for our experiments, two out of phase modes like this and this, and one in phase mode. So our mechanical oscillation frequency are on the order of megahertz, and difference between this modes that we need to basically drive is on the order of few hundred kilohertz. We also look at our coherence time, and we find it's the coherence time of this motional excitation in our case are well order of magnitude larger than the our gate time. So we hope to preserve our quantum states for a few operation even without the error correction. Okay, so let's see how well it works. So let's start with something simple. Let's start with the Fock states, right? So we prepare Fock states in different modes. We run our control swap test and we measure the spin at the end to find out what is the overlap between the states. And as you see, well, for Fock states, it works reasonably well. For zero and one, and then fidelity goes down, 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 and goes below 50% for n equals to five. And the reason for it is, of course, you know, the our preparation of the preparation errors for the Fock state, as well as the heating of the ions and diffusion of the ions in this case, which gets worse as you go to the higher states of the harmonic oscillator. Well, to make sure that we also can control the phase, we also look at the overlap between coherent superposition, because before between superposition of the Fock states, so we prepare two superpositions, zero plus one, and where is the phase? And indeed, we see the, that we can measure the overlap between the states. Well, it also works for coherent states. For example, here we just prepare two coherent state and then the measure where is the phase between this state, and at some point they do overlap and at some point they don't. And it even works for the squeeze state. So we prepare two different squeeze state and then we rotate the angle, the phase of the squeezing parameter. So we rotate the angle between two different squeeze states. We see it works. So when the two states overlap, we actually have this relatively large overlap. When they are orthogonal, well, the overlap is small. Okay, looks like our swap test works reasonably well. So what can we do with those states? Is there any practical application that we can pursue? Well, one of the example is calculation of inner product of vectors, right? So the measurement of the overlap between two quantum states is equivalent to basically calculations of the inner product of vectors. If we encode our vectors in the amplitude of the quantum states. And it's actually faster if we have a quantum computer because we can estimate this overlap in the single shot compared to, you know, classical computers that will take n steps to calculate this inner product. Well, of course, you know, if you want to encode vector into the state of oscillator, you better have the way to control this oscillator or at least first few states of this harmonic oscillator. Turns out, well, that if you have this James Cunning interaction between spin and motion, you can use this very old idea of Law and Eberle, so which was actually implemented with trapped ions in 2003. So we just reproduce this result. And the idea is, you know, once you just give this algorithms a set of numbers, and it produces you the set of carrier and sideband pulses that at the end gives this quantum states with amplitude that you want. It works, it's a very old techniques, and it also works for us quite well. So what can we do with this tools? We can have inner product estimation and we can load our classical data as the quantum states. Well, one of the applications that we want to pursue is some, you know, machine learning algorithm. And the first algorithm that came to our mind is the k-mean clustering algorithm that basically partitions a data point into k cluster, in which each data point belongs to the cluster with the nearest mean vector. And this cluster are basically close together, but the point of the cluster are close together, but far away from each other. So how do we do it? How does an algorithm work? Well, so we just choose the centroid vectors kind of randomly in the beginning and assign each data point to the cluster with the nearest centroid. And for that, we need to some measure of how close it is, and the inner product is a perfect measure to do it. Okay, once we did this assignment, recalculate these means based on which points were assigned to which cluster. So we have new set of centroid. We do again our assignment step, measure the distance between centroid and the other points, and keep doing it until our algorithm converge and assignment do not change. Since we have a quantum computer, well, it's easier for us to make actually to use quantum data and classify different quantum states of harmonic oscillator. For example, coherent state, squeeze state, and Fock state. So we prepared five different coherent state, five different Fock, squeezed vacuum state, and five different superpositions of 0 plus 1. We throw it into our algorithm and we try to see what we get at the end. So we use the swap test to estimate distance and we encode the centroids vector as the state of harmonic oscillator using this Low and Epperly algorithm. And that's what we got at the end. So we started with squeezed vacuum, superposition of Fock states, and coherent state, and our centroids is just we randomly choose like Fock state 0, 1, and 2. And as this algorithm progresses, you see it tries to find some order in these parameters. And after 4 steps, the algorithm converges and all our states are classified correctly. So the Fock states are in one cluster, squeezed vacuums are in the the superposition of 0 plus 1 and then 1 cluster, the squeezed vacuum state in the other cluster and coherent state are in the set cluster. So if you want to look how the centroid vectors goes from one step to another, well, here is a few cross section. I mean, we have like 5-dimensional vectors, so I just draw a bunch of cross sections for different states, and that's how these centroids basically evolve until they are close to this state. Okay, looks good. So what can we do after we classify the state? Let's throw the unknown state and try to find out whether it's which class of states it belongs to. So, and the idea is, you know, in machine learning known as the k nearest neighbor algorithm, we throw the state, we calculate distance between this state and all the other state, we take 7 closest state, and then if majority of them, let's say, are coherent state, then we say, okay, that must be coherent state too. If majority are squeezed vacuum, then okay, that must be a squeezed vacuum state too. So we try it on a bunch of states, like coherent states with vacuum, superposition, and then some crazy states that previous speaker was talking about, displaced Fock state or some superposition of everything. And indeed, when we throw the coherent state, well, the 5 out of 7 neighbors were also coherent states, so it's coherent state. So when we throw the squeezed vacuum, okay, 5 out of 7 were squeezed vacuum. And of course our quantum computer has some opinions about the displaced Fock state and about some state that doesn't really make sense to him. K also classify it to something. Okay, so in conclusion, we realize a constant depth circuit to estimate overlap of infinite dimensional bosonic modes in trapped ions, and we try to, and I hope we showed you, I convinced you that it's a valuable tool if you want to implement some kind of machine learning algorithm or maybe some other types of quantum computation. And finally, I would like to thank, you know, the members of my group, in particular, well, Chihuan, who was basically like driving force for this project, Kovei, who spent like long, long, long hours measuring all this overlaps in the man, and Charan, who started this work and demonstrated a different way for the control system. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dmitry, for the talk. That's very nice. So I don't see any questions in the chat. I have a few myself, but before that, maybe if anybody has a question and didn't write it in the chat, just unmute yourself and please ask it directly. All right. So I was wondering if these ways of characterizing the state of a harmonic oscillator with in different ways than full tomography. Is there any proof, for example, about like how fast you can characterize an arbitrary state, like in terms of like how many clusters you would need and how long it would take you, compared to say usual tomography like Wigner or characteristic function, for example?
Good question, because I don't really know the answer. I mean, we don't really extract in this way, you know, full information about the state. We just look, okay, this state is similar to the other one.
Yeah.
So that it must be coherent, but I don't really know what is the theory.
In the end, there isn't, for example, a reconstruction of density matrix going on from those classification. And is there, so I guess this work comes a bit from Radim Philipp, I guess.
Well, in a sense,
a little bit. And so is he working on a way to reconstruct, to do like, is it something known or?
I'm not sure, you know. We just tried this states because, well, that's the first that came to our mind when we, you know, when saw the control swap. So if someone wants to do a theory and find out, I'm very much interested in learning it myself.
All right. So the I have now several questions in the chat. So sorry, as I was saying, the chat is a bit finicky to scroll through. So the one question is how are the arbitrary states prepared? Do you do just numerical optimal control with your Hamiltonian?
Okay, so we basically follow this very old algorithm where it actually gives you the analytical solution, you know, if you have this James Cummings type Hamiltonian, there is a basically sequence of carrier pulses and the sidebands that you need to implement, and for given basically normalized vector, you enter it into computer, it gives you the
you don't use a closed form, right? You use an algorithm to generate.
Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. We didn't test what it is at all at the end and feedback, so we just assume it.
Probably. Cool. Could you comment on the purity of the bosonic modes? And how it affects the measurement overall?
Okay, obviously, you know, if you don't have the pure states in the bosonic mode, your overlap is reduced, right? So I'm not sure if I have the I think I didn't put the, you know, I didn't put the photo, but if you are, obviously the overlap is reduced, but our coherence time is like long enough to survive for basically a few of those gates. So it's not too bad. And surprisingly, these machine learning algorithms, they are not very sensitive to a reduction of fidelity as long as like kind of it changes smoothly for all of the states. We can still, you know, classify them correctly, but yeah, the overall contrast is reduced if you have a mixed state.
I see. Mm-hmm. And finally, there is a question from Rajir who asks if you've done multimode quantum states like EPR states and I guess like entangled cat states. Actually, I would like to piggyback on this question, talking about multimode states. I think you've also done like cross coupling between different ions that would probably give you more bosonic modes. So do you think, is there a natural extension to the classification and tomography of multimode states that you could implement in a similar platform?
It's a good question. So we haven't been thinking much about it, but in principle, it's possible. I mean, right now we have two ions, so we control four radial modes of motion. We can add one more, then we'll have six modes of motion, so six bosonic mode coupled to a few qubits. So in principle, it's possible. The question is, you know, whether we'll have whether our coherence time is long enough to you know, do this operations, because as you saw, it's, you know, right now is even for like N equals five Fox states, our fidelity, our overlap goes to like below 50%.
Yeah.
So if we can improve on it, it's, I mean, we are not limited by any fundamental factors. It's probably a technical noise that our trap frequency is just fluctuating. And we have like defacing of these ions.
So if I understand correctly, you say you have two modes that are potentially non-degenerate per spin, right?
Yes, we have two more.
If you want to add more modes and still keep this spin to bosonic mode control, you might need to entangle the spins between themselves, right?
Not really. I think, well, we can couple, see, it's trapped ion, so we can couple each spin to any of the bosonic modes, right? So.
Yes, because of the vibrational
mode. Yeah, because mode, vibrational modes, they involve all of the spins.
All right, so. Thank you, my mistake. Mm-hmm. Back on my question, Rajvir is adding that with Professor Olivier's lab, they have implemented some overlap tomography techniques and refer to an archive paper. So if you want to talk more about it, you can do it on the Slack.
Yes.
All right, so that's it for this question session. Thank you, Dmitry, again. And let's thank him for this nice talk. And I think that's the end of this session. So I'll leave the floor to the organizers regarding the rest of the conference. And thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Stephen. That was great sharing and a really great talk.